If you've ever seen the Alvin Ailey dancers, you know they redefine the word dance. One definition of dance states, move rhythmically to music, typically following a set of sequence steps. But as you will see, there is certainly nothing typical about our special guest today. So I ask, how do you define dance?
Dance is me, love, passion, anger, confusion, I oftentimes have different opinions about dance, whether or not if it's for me or if I should be doing something else. But I really love what I do as a professional dancer, the ability and the opportunities to travel and share my gift and my light with everyone is very refreshing and also healing to me and the world. Dance is universal. My name is Jeroboam Bozeman. I am originally from Brooklyn, New York, and I am a professional dancer with the Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater. I started dancing at a very young age, maybe around 11 or 12. I guess that's late in considering other dancers and how they train. And it started with me imitating Michael Jackson videos and watching videos on television and just imitating that. And then started with me continuing with me performing at local block parties and local community centers and things of that nature. And I remember having a lot of energy, and I wasn't very talkative. I was a little bit of an introvert, but I had a lot of energy, and my mom thought it'd be great if I can just dibble and dabble in everything. So I had did Taekwondo. I was a part of a cheerleading team. I played the cello, and I danced. And through all of those activities, I found myself most drawn to dance. I was dancing, singing, acting. I had attended this local community center where it was for the cultural arts, and they had everything there. And I found myself most drawn to dance. And I was introduced to dance at my junior high school, and I had met a lovely woman by the name of Miss Ruth Sestere, and she had introduced me to dance. Initially, when I had auditioned for the school, because it was an art school at the time, I didn't get accepted initially. However, my mother, she fought for me to get inside the school because I had a twin brother that attended the school, and he was here for his academics. And I remember the first week of school not having a school because my mother didn't want me to attend my magnet school because she felt like I wouldn't succeed. It wouldn't give me the best outlook on what it is that she felt or she envisioned for her children, for me. And when I finally got into my junior high school and I had started to be introduced to this thing called dance, I found myself I will say I was surprised, was shocked, overwhelmed, but overall joyful. And Mrs. Stair, she saw the energy that I had, and she kind of honed it in. And during that time period, or in general in life, that it's very, I will consider it to be very vital for a child, because it's that understanding of trying to find trying to identify who they are in the world. And between the ages of, 13 to about 14, 15, 16, it's very difficult. Children are trying to fit in, they're trying to figure out who they want to be. And having Mrs. Steer in my life, she was someone that directed me and coached me and taught me how to be a man, I feel. And she felt that I needed to dance outside of the school. And she had introduced me to a man by the name of Jamel Gaines, who is the artistic director of Creative Outlet Dance Theater of Brooklyn. And during that time, they were located in East New York, and I lived in Bedford Stuyvesant, so I would travel and commute by myself every Saturday to get dance classes. However, when I had went to the classes, no one had told me that I had to pay for these classes. So I was there taking classes, and finally I had met with administration at the time, and they were telling me, you can't be here, you know, you're not paying for classes, classes aren't free. And that's when I was like, oh, okay, well, I guess I'll speak with my mom. And I remember going back home and telling my mother that I wanted to attend dance classes, and she told me that she couldn't afford it, that she wasn't going to be able to pay for it. So I had went to my dad to see if it was possible, if he would support and see if he could pay for the classes. And they were like, it's a little difficult to pay for those classes, you know. They felt that it wouldn't help me be successful in my career. They were very interested in education, and they pushed forward in education, and they wanted me to focus on my schoolwork and try to join a debate team and things of that nature. But that didn't speak volumes to me as much as dance did. And as a result, I remember speaking with administration. I had to be about maybe 15. And I spoke with the administration, I spoke with the artistic director, and I told them, I said, hey, look, I would love to be a part of the dance school. I would love to train. However, it's just financially difficult for my family to be able to sustain the payments, just because it was just my parents and it was seven of us. So it was a little difficult. So they let me come on scholarship. And I remember training there and falling in love with dance and meeting all of these other young dancers. And I remember being nervous because the dancers at Creative Outlet, they have this energy and this poise that you don't cross in other dance schools. And what I mean by that is that the kids that was there that I had danced with, they were so sure and secure with themselves and their dancing, it became intimidating to me. So as a result, I had stopped dancing because I felt that I wouldn't be as good as everyone else. So I had stopped dancing for a while, and I said, I'm just gonna focus on school. You know, I couldn't afford it anyway, so I might as well just focus on school. And I had took a couple of months off, and then I decided that I wanted to dance again. And I had attended the Dance Theater of Harlem's summer program, and actually one of the teachers that was inside of my junior high school, he took me, Mr. Edwin Robinson, he took me to the audition. And he walked me in, and I remember sitting on the floor with a white shirt, black tights, white ballet slippers, trying to get accepted. And then I had got into the school, and I remember training in Dance Theater of Harlem for about a couple summers. And I tried it for a school year, and then I had begun to lose interest. And I wanted to do other things. And I remember I would still go back to Creative Outlet to see the kids, and I was impressed because they were performing. And that's where I felt I needed to be. I needed to be on the stage. I felt that I had some things that I needed to say artistically at that time, which is very funny because I was like 15 years old. but I had a lot to say, and I had went back to creative outlet, and I started dancing again with the school. And I remember I would go to the creative outlet during the year, and then I would find a summer program to attend. And one summer program I had attended the Joffrey Ballet School. And I was there for one summer intensive, and I really loved it. During that time, the artistic director was George de la Peña, and he was amazing. I mean, I really enjoyed how active he was within the school. He would teach men's class, and I was the only black boy in the class, and he was so patient. And he was so cultivating and nurturing. It kind of blew me away. Then I remember Jamel had called me because we have a really great relationship. He's like my dance dad. And he told me that the company was getting ready to go on tour and they needed dancers. So he asked if I could join the company and go with them on tour. And I believe their first stop was in London, England. And I was 16 years old. And I told them, yes, of course, I would love to go. Are you kidding me? Like, why wouldn't I go? And I remember speaking with my mom and my dad and telling them that I wanted to go to London, England. And they didn't really approve of it. They said, we don't recommend that you go. You need to stay focused on school, you know, you need to graduate. So let's put our energy in that. Let's focus on graduating. And I said, you know, this is an opportunity of a lifetime. I don't know if I'm going to get this again. So I went to London, England anyway. And I had, this is so bad to say, but I had forged my parents' signature. But they did know where I was. I did inform them that I was going to go. And although they didn't approve. And I had my phone on, and I made sure that I was in communications with my parents all the time. And when I came back, my mom asked me, she said, okay, so how was it? And I told her it was great, I had a fun time, it was incredible. And she said, okay, so you know, you have to get ready for college. And I told her, I said, I don't think I'm going to college. And when I told her that, I literally saw her jaw drop. And she said, well, what are you going to do? And I said, I'm going to dance. And she took a step back, and the face that she gave me was almost as if she was tickled by what I said. And she said, so how are you going to make a living off of dance? And I said, I'm going to join a company and I'm going to perform and it's all going to make sense. And she said, well, you know, it doesn't really sound concrete. She said, what's going to happen when your legs give out, or if, you know, you injure yourself or you break your ankle, you know, what are you going to have to fall on? And I said, I'm not thinking like that. I said, you know, dance is my choice that I want to pursue as a career, and I don't have a backup plan. And she said, well, it doesn't sound very smart. And I told her, okay, well, I'm gonna try it anyway. And she said, well, I can't take care of anyone who doesn't follow my rules. Anyone who lives in my household has to abide by my rules. And if you're going to be here, you have to be in college. So after telling her that I wasn't going to college, I had to be about 18. I had moved out, and I moved to Philadelphia, where I danced with the Philadelphia Dance Company, also known as Philadelphia. And I was with the company for about 2 years, and the artistic director there is Joe Myers Brown. And when she hired me, I was very young. This was my first real job outside of Jamel, because he was my dance school, you know, and I trained there, and I performed perform there. So to me, when I had joined the company, it was kind of like, oh, okay, I'm just dancing with the company, but here it is. I stepped outside of my comfort zone the first time, and working with someone and working with people who I have no clue who they are. And the first year, I will admit, it was extremely hard. It was the first time me living on my own. I had moved out, I was living on my own, and I guess I was being an adult. That's the bills that we kind of take for granted that comes, the rent, the light, things of that nature. But yeah, I had to be an adult. And also I had to create somewhat of a name for myself. And it was very important that I presented myself well. I remember oftentimes that the work that we did, it was not easy. It was very, very intense. It was very athletic. And Miss Brown, she didn't take any mess. I mean, if she didn't like something, she would come and tell you. She probably would say it in front of everyone so you would know that she was talking to you. But also, Miss Brown has this beautiful spirit that kind of remind me of home. If I needed anything, Miss Brown would take care of it. There had been a couple of times I had been a little irresponsible, and Miss Brown had assisted me with making sure that I was secure in my situations. I remember I had injured my back, and she was paying for acupuncture every week out of her pocket. And it was a really great experience. And I had really became very independent there. I left the company when I was 21. And I had decided that I wanted to further my knowledge in dance and expose myself a little bit more. So I had moved all the way to Seattle, Washington, where I was working with a brilliant choreographer by the name of Donald Byrd. And I was a part of the Spectrum Dance Theater there in Seattle. And I had heard so much about Donald Byrd, and I had been a big fan of his work. And when I finally got there, it was pretty much straight into work. And what I loved about Mr. Byrd is that he's so articulate and he's so direct. And sometimes dance can be, we can make it, or dancers can make dance so confusing and so much bigger than what it is. And I felt that Mr. Byrd simplified it. He made it very simple. It was like, well, here's the reason why this isn't working out, because this is here, and if you do this, this will make it there, now try it. And then you would do it, and then you were like, oh, okay, I get it. That's pretty much my transition from where it began to where I am today. Thank you.
I could watch Jeroboam dance all day. What a gift. What a talent. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Arch Resuscitation. Thank you for tuning in. And please come back and join us on the next episode. Jeroboam, you keep dancing.